Nice job, you guys. Good good rehearsal. Let's record one.
Oh, man. Hello, everyone, and welcome to our first video in our coffee series chat. My name is Kim Larson, and I've worked with Medtronic for 17 years. My background is clinical. I'm a registered dietitian and diabetes educator. And in my current role at Medtronic Diabetes, what my team and I do is really help bring new products to market after they have been approved by the FDA and really make sure that those products are successful in the market. And we also plan programs that help patients gain access to our products. And I'm really thrilled to be joined in this coffee series chat by my counterpart, Ali Dianaty. So Ali, why don't you introduce yourself?
Thanks, Kim. My name is Ali Dianaty. I'm responsible for product innovation and operations for Medtronic Diabetes. I've been with the company about 8 years, and really my job is about bringing new products to people living with type 1. So everything from the conceptual design of it, to the actual R&D of it, to then the clinical and the regulatory pieces, and then ultimately how we make them falls within my purview.
Perfect. So as you can hear, the work that Ali, myself, and our teams really do can sometimes feel a little bit behind the scenes. And one of our favorite things to do is really connect directly with our community. And so we really thought, what better way to do that than to jump on video and really answer some of the questions that we continue to hear from our community that are frequent and seem to come up most frequent on social media. And so we're going to dive into some of these top questions, and we really hope to continuously evolve this series so that we can really meet your needs. So maybe to jump right in, let's start with one really popular conversation that we've seen bubble up in the community, both from doctors and diabetes educators, but more importantly from patients. And that's really around AID, or automated insulin delivery algorithms, really trying to understand across the marketplace of AID systems in the US, what are the differences and the benefits? So Ali, you're probably best to answer this question. When you think about the MiniMed 780G AID system and its algorithm, how does it really differ from other systems that are out there in the market?
I think there's a few important things that make it different. If we look in our past, we actually had a target in our last generation product, the 670G, of 120 milligrams per deciliter. And believe it or not, that was the single biggest thing people asked us to change and to make it lower. And hence, that's what we have done on the MiniMed 780G. So once again, the target that it's shooting for is 100 milligrams per deciliter. So that helps keep people in range, of course. From a physiologic perspective, is what people with normal control would probably end up being at if they were wearing a sensor. So then the other thing that it has is the ability to adjust insulin if you're above 100 on a 5-minute to 5-minute interval. And what that means is that it can react and respond much faster and keep you in range longer. And especially it can do this even more aggressively when it sees a meal or when you need a correction. And so it's able to provide correction doses as well. And in case you have forgotten to bolus, or potentially you have underestimated the number of carbs that you had at lunch, breakfast, or dinner, it will make up that difference and provide the added insulin to, again, bring you down to that target and do it in a safe way to avoid what everybody is trying to avoid, which is, of course, avoiding hypoglycemia. And so no one wants to go low, and we make sure that the algorithm is safe, and we put a whole bunch of safeguards in there that, so just in case it is providing that extra insulin to bring you back down to that target, that it's not giving you too much and get you to go low. So that's kind of the premise of what we have done here, and of course done this without any extra work We try to make sure that it doesn't buzz or beep interrupt your day-to-day life. And really what we're really trying to do is make sure that we keep your diabetes management in the background by taking care of more and more of your insulin dosing needs with these features. So bottom line is the 100 target, able to adjust insulin every 5 minutes, and then it has this corrections to get you back into range. And then just in case you forgot for a meal, it has meal detection to add that extra insulin you need to make up for that difference.
That's right. And I think lastly, to just summarize your last point there, that burden reduction is really important. And I think for those of you that have been a part of our Medtronic diabetes community, that is one item that we continue to really focus on, is how do we move diabetes into the background for you and really make sure that the algorithm itself is helping to achieve your goals. So I love that. Okay, so let's talk about the next most frequent question that we've been getting. So sure. When you think about an AID system, you have the algorithm that you just described. You have the insulin pump that's delivering insulin. You have the transmitter with a sensor that's really sensing that glucose in the interstitial fluid, and it's kind of feeding that information into the algorithm. And the Guardian 4 sensor is the sensor that we use with the MiniMed 780G. And one of the questions that we hear is, how long should I expect the Guardian 4 sensor to stay on my body? And how long should I expect to be able to wear it? And it seems as though people have different experiences. So Ali, can you comment on what should people expect in terms of wear time based on the data that we're seeing? And then maybe we could talk a little bit about some of the education and resources that we have out there for support.
Sure. Yeah, it's a very important question, and I get asked it a lot. I think the first thing to note is that we've designed it to last up to 7 days. And I use those words on purpose, up to 7 days, because clinically speaking, what we saw in our clinical trials is an average of 6.1 days. And ironically, as we've gone through the launch and seen it through Europe and in the U.S., our average to date in the real world as well has stayed very constant at 6.1 days on average. So I'm sure there's a lot of people that are thinking, well, then why do you say seven? And this is why we use the words up to seven, number one. And then number two, this is why we ship for a given month five sensors, because 5 times 6 is 30, and that's for 30 days of use. So we know that it's not always going to last up to 7 days. The data supports that. And as a result, we support everyone that purchases our products by providing enough sensors for 6 days of use. And so hence why we ship that many, is to make sure that we have the coverage. Yeah. The other thing that I would say is a lot of people ask, well, what can I do to get the full 7 days, you know, out of the sensor? And there are a few things there that do help. One of them is, making sure that it's taped well onto the body, because if it moves around at all, believe it or not, it will shut off, because the measurements will get affected and it will recognize that and then shut off the sensor early. So, you know, appropriately taping it down, and I know it takes quite a bit of work to be able to do that, and we have a next generation sensor coming that should help take care of some of those things. But for now, the taping and making sure that it's secure on the arm is very important. Now, the other thing I also get asked is, why is this only on the arm? And the reason for that is, we've seen, and this is consistent with all competitive sensors as well, the arm just gives people the best performance and the best longevity. And a lot of that, again, has to come back to the notion of it being able to be stable relative to other parts of the body. The back of the arm turns out to be the place where it has less tendency to get knocked off, number one. And number two, the movement of the sensor on the body is very limited on the back of the arm relative to something like the abdomen, where you have many degrees of freedom and the ability to bend and twist, which can create problems for the tape and maintaining that stability of the sensor on the body. So all in all, we have many resources to help people, either videos or otherwise, and I'm sure Kim's going to talk about that, to help get the sensor on their arm and taped appropriately. And then more importantly, we've chosen that because it provides the best possible performance.
Yes. And so what I heard, just to summarize, is we should expect it to last up to 7 days. On average, we're seeing it last about 6. But because of the way we actually package the sensors, that should give patients ample supply to really cover that 30 days. And I think what I also heard you say is the data really supports that wearing it on the back of your arm is the best place to wear it for all the reasons that you just listed. And so some of the questions that we hear around wearing it on the back of the arm is, I'm not exactly sure how to do that. What should that look like? Or if I'm having challenges, how can I have somebody learn to assist me? And so, as Ali mentioned, we actually have a variety of resources. We'll provide some links for you that really help explain step by step some of the best practices and tips for how you can insert the sensor on the back of your arm that will really ensure the best days of wear experience. So if that's something that you're struggling with, I would encourage you to look at those resources. If you're struggling doing it yourself, grab a buddy. And there are some great tips and techniques and resources out there to help you and those around you that support your diabetes journey. The other that I'll mention is, we know that life happens. And sometimes your sensor doesn't last the up to 7 days. And so we've created a self-serve resource where you can actually serve a sensor replacement. And that sensor replacement will really be an easy to access online form that will allow you to make sure that you have enough sensors to really continue that sensor therapy. So hopefully that is helpful. So maybe to close us out, let's transition to our most recent and I would say exciting news. So a few weeks ago, we actually made 2 announcements. The first of which is our CGM called Simplera has been approved. And the second is we have gone into an agreement with Abbott. And so what I'd love to talk about, Ali, is a little bit of perspective of what this approval means and what the announcement of the agreement with Abbott means. And then we'll get into some maybe timing and expectations that patients can have.
Great. Yeah. So Simplera, first and foremost, it is our next gen version of our sensor. It doesn't require finger sticks, doesn't require over tape, doesn't require charging. Very simple to put onto the body. And the form factor is about half the size of what we have for a Guardian 4 sensor today. So we're very excited to get that in the hands of people, mainly because it solves a lot of the things that people have been asking us for a new next-gen sensor. And it does that in a very small, comfortable-to-wear package. And hence, we're doing everything we can to get it out there as fast as we can to people. And to that end, very excited to finally have it approved. And then the other on the Abbott deal, we're at the beginning of this, but really our intent is to create options for people that are using our products and allow them to have choices within our ecosystem. And one of the main things that we are interested in doing is making sure that we can do that and maintain the high level of service and support that we are able to provide. And so the bottom line is we're calling this a deal where though Abbott's going to provide, let's just say, the sensor technologies for it, it's really going to be a Medtronic branded sensor, so that when someone, God forbid, does have an issue, they know who to call, which would be Medtronic, and Medtronic would handle that for them. And from an ecosystem perspective, ordering and managing their prescriptions and everything like that, they would still have one stop shop, so to speak, through Medtronic. And so we're trying to improve things for people where they have choices, but then still get the same level of service and support instead of having to deal with multiple people in order to get their supplies. So that's why we're very excited about the Abbott deal as well.
Yes.
In terms of timing, I'm sorry I can't share that right now, but we are diligently working to make sure that we can get it into people's hands as soon as possible. But just know that it is a massive priority for us internally to get both Simplera out there and completion of this integration with the Abbott sensor so that, you know, people can have the option.
Yes. Hopefully we've been able to address some of the burning questions that are on your mind with this coffee chat series. And we really want to make sure that you appreciate how much your feedback, your questions, your advice and ideas we take to heart. I know it's something that my team and Ali's team are looking at all of the time, because really our goal is to make your life easier. And so we want to make sure that the programs and the products that we are bringing to you, that you're excited about that and you see a thread of your feedback and ideas that you're sharing with us in them. So Ali, why don't you close out our first coffee chat series for us?
Just want to say thanks for everyone that watched and to those that are wearing Medtronic products. We really appreciate you and want to continue to do everything we can for you to forget that you have diabetes.
Awesome. So thanks again for joining. If you have any questions or comments for us, please drop those into the comment section below. And thanks so much for tuning in. We'll see you next time.